Aftershocks TV. We're back here with you guys and gals for another episode. And we got a great one for you today as our guest. You all remember as the guitarist and original voice of Pennsylvania heavy rock veteran CKY. And today he joins us to talk about his band 96 Bitter Beings. I'd like to welcome to the show guitarist, vocalist, Deron Miller. Deron, thanks for coming on Aftershocks. How are you, man?
I'm good. It's my pleasure. How's everybody out there?
I guess you're all doing good, hopefully. Cool, man. All right, man. Well, shit. Let's get it going, man. 96 Bitter Beings. I mean, you guys are getting ready to unleash the band's sophomore release. It's titled Synergy Restored. It comes out November 4th on Nuclear Blast. Mm-hmm. It's a follow-up, of course, to the very impressive debut campaign that was released back in 2018. And, you know, for those who are not aware of the band yet, or just anybody who knows and has been a fan of your work with CKY over the years, Deron, I mean, I think they're absolutely going to relate to the band and album. You know, it's definitely obviously in the same vicinity as what you did with CKY, but it's not a carbon copy. It's definitely got a lot of sonic differences, still within the same vernacular as what you did with them. But, you know, so why don't you start us off by talking about the reason, I guess, that you decided to write in a similar fashion as you did with CKY. Did it just make sense, I guess, to do something similar instead of starting a new band or project from scratch at this point in your career?
I didn't really have any choice. I mean, when I go with certain styles, when it's rock, I just have my style. Like, I can't really describe it, but it's impossible to get away from. It's not intentional, mm-hmm. but it is. It's just the way the music comes out. The music that I wrote for CKY sounds like what happens if I work. That's what happens. That's the result. So even if I wanted to change my style, that when I did some death metal some years back, people could still tell it wasn't, you know, that far removed from what I was doing. So I guess it's just the way I think. It's the way I work musically.
Okay. Yeah, absolutely, man. Well, one of the changes I was, you know, that I noticed really over the years with you is your vocals. And what's interesting, I think, about your style and approach throughout the years is that gradually, whether it was with, you know, CKY albums or now with these last two 96 Bitter Beings records, is that like the tone and pitch in your vocals have, I think, seemed to gradually, and maybe it's just me, but they seem to get a little higher on each record, you know, which is interesting because usually with singers, we usually hear the exact opposite, where they normally have those higher tone and pitch vocals early on in their musical careers, and then eventually it kind of drops down with the age and just the wear and tear of the rock and roll, you know, lifestyle and all that. But so I guess my question is, how have you been able to really preserve your vocal cords so that you can still sing at that level? And B, I mean, is it a conscious decision over the years to sort of maybe gradually do just that with your music? Or is this just, once again, what just comes out naturally when you're recording?
It just goes with what, you know, I don't any wear and tear on my voice. I think that now than I ever was. I never really thought I was a very good singer, but I worked so, you know, working on these records for the last 5 years, I've gotten such practice, and I've always put so many vocal tracks on every song that we have so many things to pick from when we're mixing. So whatever suits the song, you know, I remember there was a song called A Number One Roller Rager, and I had a really hard time hitting the note in that chorus when we do it. And now it just seems like, you know, it's no problem. So I think my voice has gotten better, and I've been able to do maybe harmonies and lower stuff as well. It's in there.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, I do notice when you're singing live, though, I think it's hard for you not to go into those harsh growls at the end of certain lines. You definitely still have that metallic spirit in you. I mean, is it hard for you to consciously, you know, not sing like that when you're up there, when you've done it, you know, with the other projects, like you said, a lot of the death metal stuff you did? I mean, is it hard for you to stay away from those growls, since it's kind of natural, I'm sure, for you to go into them?
So natural. When I get up on stage, I kick right into what I've always done on stage. It's really, really bizarre. It's like being to, it's like riding. You know, it just doesn't change. You hit the pedals and go. And I don't consciously try to make any changes or anything. And if I do, it never works I just get to do it, or just whatever comes naturally is what I do. And I have really bad stage fright still. And as soon as I get up on stage, it kind of goes away, and then I go into what I do live. It doesn't, it's like a, almost an unconscious thing where the main goal is to just to play and sing as well as I can, but I can't change my behavioral patterns at all. And everything I used to scream on, I still scream on, and all the new stuff gets its own way of treatment as well. So it's just the way it is. I haven't really changed. I just think I'm getting better both on stage, technically it used to be, but it's the same thing. It really, it's just a new attitude and a new time.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, let's go ahead and let's talk about the new record here, Synergy Restored. I believe, you know, from what I've seen already, the album obviously was, it was actually recorded right around the same time that you also recorded the last record, Campaign. I remember, you know, you did this crowdfunding at the time. And it states, you know, in the press release, it states that this album, Synergy Restored, had always been intended for a wider release. And I'm just curious as to why exactly that is. Is it because it might be, this record might be a little more maybe accessible to the common rock fan who aren't really as, you know, into the heavier stuff? Because, you know, Campaign was a pretty definitely heavy record. So talk about why this was always intended for a wider release than Campaign.
Well, I think the understanding is when we did the crowdfunding, there was no record label. So we were going to do the first album, DIY, which is all by myself, which the fans were very supportive, and the amount that they gave us allowed us to buy equipment and all the stuff that we needed to record the albums. And I had wanted to send Campaign out to those people that helped us, and then it got leaked, which I didn't think would happen, but it was stupid. But as far as getting it out to a broader audience, the first album was do it yourself physically. It sold out. We have to repress it, and I don't know what we're going to do about that, but right now all the copies that we printed up are gone. So for this record, it was all about finding a deal and getting distribution so that I don't have to sit at home and send out 3,000 CDs by myself in this very room, actually.
Oh, wow. And, okay.
That's what I've been doing over the last 4 years is shipping CDs by myself. And so, yeah, it was good to get on Nuclear Blast. And now all I have to do is ship out the vinyl that they printed for us. But I'm more than happy to do that.
Sure, no doubt. Now, so because you recorded both albums at the same time, or at the same time, I mean, how were you able, I guess, to sort of delineate or separate the tracks into the two records? Did you just, was there any specific way you sort of selected the songs for each record, or you just kind of just chose whatever you felt, you know, on those first records?
Campaign is kind of sort of like a sampler of things that I've done in the past that I really like to do, different kinds of music, like instrumentals, mellow shoegazer type stuff. Like there's a song on there called On and On and On. That's a lot different from, it's kind of similar to some stuff that I did on Volume One. It's kind of like the Volume One of 96 Bitter Beings. It has a heavy opening track. It has a cover track. It has an instrumental. It has a song written by somebody that's not me. And it has, a song reworked from another band. And, it's just different in that each song has a reason. It's got like a cover. We have Beat It on there. We have a ballad at the end. Like everything is kind of like a sampler of like where I'm at that point, what we're doing now. And then for Synergy, we wanted to save the songs that kind of float by themselves that are on their own level. And when Campaign came out, we spent the next couple of years tweaking them. And right until we handed in the album, we were still fixing things. So they're very different in that they were recorded at the same time, but they were tweaked and dealt with and cared for differently than each other.
Okay. So got it. Absolutely. Well, let's get into talking about some of the tracks off of Synergy Restored. Obviously the first single that was released a few months ago, Vaudeville's Revenge, real cool video you released for this song too. That is also directed, I know, by a very familiar name and face within CKY Jackass film. Absolutely. So I guess talk about Vaudeville's Revenge, you know, what the song's about, as well as how that video kind of came all together.
it's just a metaphor for how, you know, technology has kind of made things that we used to love so much obsolete. In this case, fictionally, it's about the 20s. It's people that used to be in vaudeville and do their routines with fire breathing and dancing and comedy and magic and all that stuff. You know, they had something going, and then TV came and wiped it out. And it's kind of like the idea of bringing back some old ideas that are still good ideas. And and it's basically that simple. I think that a lot of the old ideas are still good ideas. They might not be new ideas, but they're the ideas that we should still be using. You know, and my preferences and most people's preferences in getting music is on a physical format. So I miss the old days of walking into a record store and sifting through and being able to do that. You can't do that anymore. And so it's kind of like I made it a fictional story based on what happened with vaudeville and how the people that used to be involved with that show, you know, come back zombified and go after everybody that's into this digital shit. It's kind of like analog versus digital in a battle to the death. I'd love to make a movie about it, but you never had that much time. You only got 4 minutes to get that shit out.
Yeah. And you're right about, you know, it really does suck these days that, you know, that whole, you know, going into a record store or going on a hunt, you know, for a record and going to multiple record stores looking for that record. It's just gone. Like you said, there's no record stores.
You just click on Amazon or eBay now and you get what you want. But, you know, part of the fun of it used to be that hunt.
Yep.
Like going somewhere and wondering, are they going to have this, this album that I'm driving out here to get? And, you know, it used to be really fun to find stuff that it was hard to find. And now everything's available in a click, and it's just not as fun as it used to be. And back then, you know, if you spent $16 on a CD, you gave it more of a chance rather than if you click on something on YouTube. You can just click off right away if you don't like it in the first 10 seconds. So it's changed a lot. But, you know, I've always been praying and hoping that vinyl would make a comeback, and it has. And I was surprised to see that vinyl would resonate with younger people, and they would eventually find out how important it is. And every day it's growing and growing and growing. People are buying record players. Walmart and Target are carrying vinyl now. It's just, I could see it growing, and I'm a vinyl freak, as you can see. I can see you are too.
Yes, absolutely. So,
It's just really important because everything sounds better on there. And I just love everything. I've been collecting vinyl my whole life, and everything sounds better on there. There's nothing that doesn't sound better on vinyl. So one of the key factors in being in this band is getting to see everything put out on physical format, especially vinyl.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. No, absolutely. And it is. It's the best format. I don't care what anyone says. You got a lot of people that, you know, argue, complain, it sounds like shit on vinyl. It's like, no, not at all. I mean, they don't like the clicks and everything. Well, there you go.
Right. The yeah, they don't like the crackles. Yeah, they don't like the crackles. But you know what? Turn it louder then. The music will drown out the crackles. Trust me.
Absolutely. Yeah, no doubt. Well, let's get into talking about the band's latest single, Wish Me Dead. I mean, you know, real catchy hooks throughout that whole song. Great lyrics. I think a lot of people could definitely relate to those lyrics these days where, mm-hmm. I mean, from what I can tell, or what I'm, I guess, observing from the song is, you know, it's focused on really talking about how people really are just so focused on maybe getting enjoyment out of seeing other people fail and suffer. Yeah. Right. I mean, so talk a little about that. Yeah.
Well, it's just weird because it's really easy to spend time on trying to make sure someone doesn't succeed than it is. It's of course, it's hard work to succeed, you know, but a lot of people find it easier to do less work, but it's actually more time, less work on trying to get somebody to fail. It's a negative thing. It's not a positive message. It's just something that I think everybody has to deal with at some time. And I guess this is the best way for me to have, you know, just to describe that. Mm-hmm. And it's just, you know, it's not a really original look on it, but it's just something that, like I said, everybody has to deal with it. And it's annoying because I don't understand that. And I never really did understand it. You know, mm-hmm. Is anybody really happy for anyone when something happens to them, if they get married or,
I know. Does it make their life better? You know, it's like, yeah, exactly.
Right. It's just something, you know, it's something that I put into the songs that I dig from the past. If I'm not currently feeling that way, it's hard, more difficult to describe. But I do put things that, and a lot of songs, my songs are either fictional or they're telling stories or they're based on negative things that happen in life. And all the songs on this album are kind of split into two. There's some stories in there. There's some things that happen. There's a cross between reality and fiction. And Wish Me Dead is just, it just came out as probably a day or two after somebody did something to one of us or somebody that I know, where it was just obvious. Like, jealousy is a transparent thing. We can't hide it. Everyone's, I'm not jealous. But when I see it, whether it's aimed at me or if it's aimed at somebody else, I can always tell. And it's really embarrassing that they don't realize that that's what's going on. You know, there's no other way to put it, you know, so it makes me laugh. Yeah. It kind of makes me laugh because I see it in my kids a lot, too, you know.
Sure.
When they get jealous and they get angry about something that's good for someone else and they have a problem with it. I'm like, what's the problem? You're jealous. They're like, no, I'm not. Yeah. I'm not. That's funny. When people get caught being jealous, I think it's hysterical. I always crack up. It's always good for a laugh. I mean, it's just funny. It's like hiding a boner or something. You can't. if you have one, don't tell me there's something else down there. You know, it's like, I don't know. It's hard to explain, but I find it very hilarious. Jealousy is one of the funniest things about human behavior. Mm.
Yeah. Well, you said your kids, but you know, your kids is one thing. You know, when you're adults, that's another thing when you've got jealousy. So,
That's different because the kids don't know yet.
They don't know exactly.
But when an adult gets jealous, it's really embarrassing, and it's just
it's pathetic. Funny. Yeah, it's funny, but it's pathetic too. Yeah, no doubt.
Well, it's I should have led with that. It basically goes with me finding jealousy hilarious. That's what that song is about.
Okay, very cool. Well, you know, like I was talking a little bit earlier, I mean, you know, your sound, I mean, especially now the 96-bit of being sound, you know, as we were saying, it's on the same trajectory as what you've done over the years with CKY. And if you listen, though, to your old, you know, your old band's last record, The Phoenix, you compare it to what we're hearing on these two records, I think it's safe to say that, you know, at least to me, but that most, you know, old-school CKY fans are going to feel, I just think, more aligned with what you're doing now than what they've done since you've left. So, I mean, other than wanting to continue or just naturally, you know, writing in the same style of music that you do, Is there also a part of you that also wants to, you know, show, I guess, maybe the CKY fans and just your music fans in general, that you were, you know, basically essentially the guy responsible for most of what that band was musically, and that you can continue to do that and carry on your own legacy through the music of 96 Beater Beans? Is that anything to do with that?
Well, I don't think that there was like a conscious decision. Okay, now I'm going to show them who was really doing it. I think the fans already knew that. And it wasn't like I was going to stop writing this music the way that I always recorded it. So, of course, it's going to sound like CKY, because I was the guy that made you know, wrote that stuff. Mm-hmm. And we pretty much used the same method, and that's the only method that I know. And if somebody else wants to go and try to do CKY and have it sound like what I do, and I'm not there, it really doesn't make any sense, because the sound was not that simple. You know, it wasn't just a regular band that can go on without, you know, or just a generic band. It's like a specific sound. And if somebody does a specific sound or a specific way and you don't work with them anymore, then you're not going to get that. So, I mean, I think it's obvious, but I think the fans always knew that. It doesn't really concern me much what fans say about all that stuff. If it gets to be gossipy, you know, I used to be into all that gossip, and I used to love to look at all the hate and the stupid comments that everybody read. But this was when the internet was still new and fresh, and I was interested. And, you know, everybody's, you don't know who the hell is writing this stuff. So after a while, you just get tired of it. And I got tired of reading. I don't read anything. I don't read any comments. I don't go searching for good stuff, and I don't go searching for bad stuff. You know, it's just whatever, you know. I have my Facebook and I have Instagram, and people reach out to me and I talk to them, but I don't read messages that people have already left, you know, in a public
smart
or something like that. So I do the music now. I don't have the same horrible attitude that I had in the past.
Okay. No doubt. You know, it's smart for you. Yeah. Well, it's a lot of energy to hate, you know. That's the thing too. It takes up a lot of energy.
Oh, yeah.
And wasted energy, really, you know.
It is. Yeah. It doesn't get anywhere. And me and even the band back in the old days, we spent so much time hating things where we could have spent time doing something besides that. So it was a waste of time, but it is what it is. And, you know, learning from it and going forward, it's just too old for that.
You know, just, you know, talking again about your sound, you know, with your music over the years, it's really one of those things. It's really, I've always had a hard time explaining your sound and style to people, you know, I mean, because it's very unique. I mean, it's got a lot of different influences in it. Your guitar tone also is very unique. And there's just so much more that goes into your songs and music than just a guitar, bass, and drums, especially with 96 Spirit of Beings. I mean,
I think without being arrogant, you know, I just think that I have the right to have that opinion, is that you said it's very unique and people tell me that's why it's impossible for somebody to do it if I'm not there. Mm-hmm. So if it wasn't unique, then maybe so, but I get that a lot. And to me, it's just normal. Like when we finish a song or finish writing something and it's done, it just feels like something that I've done, but it doesn't seem so abnormal that people are going to be able to point it directly at me. Sometimes mm-hmm. I think that, you know, I am pulling from all different kinds of inspiration and all different artists and vibes and stuff, but they all say it comes right back to me. Even when I'm doing death metal, you can't get away from it. I always end up sounding like me, and that's mm-hmm. a great thing to have. It's like the best thing you can have, doing this mm-hmm. stuff.
Yeah, no, I totally agree, man. Like I said, and it is. I mean, anyone who's listened to your music, like I said, it is so very unique, which is, it stands out. You know, there's no doubt. And I think that's why you've been able to put out some great records over the years. So just another quick thing. I mean, I alluded to earlier. Obviously, I'm sure you're sick of talking about this, but the only reason why I have to bring it up too is because it's you know, there was a comeback of it this year. Was obviously the old band, you know, the CKY band, your connection to Jackass back in the day. Obviously, it was a major reason for you guys, you know, getting that initial recognition, a boost out of the underground back in the early 2000s. Yeah. But I mean, although, you know, obviously it was a blessing with that connection, at the same time, I guess maybe, I mean, you tell me, but, you know, was it one of those catch-22 things where it was like, sure, it helped us, but at the same time, we can't get away from being connected, and we're always going to kind of be, you know, looked at it with, as, you know, CKY equals that, especially with the Camp Kill Yourself crew and the rest of it, you know, is that spot on?
Well, it's something that... Before Jackass came about, what we were doing was really unique, and it didn't have any commercial success, and that we were a group of friends mm-hmm. where one group of them were filming videos of doing stunts and funny shit. We were the soundtrack to it, and that's all it was. But when Jackass came along, they put it together and then sold it mm-hmm. and we went along with it. The problem is that when somebody has to ride the coattails of something big just to get noticed, they're usually not that good. Mm-hmm. And people see, okay, oh, if it wasn't for this person, you know, it's like, take for instance, Kelly Osbourne being a singer and putting mm-hmm. out a record. I mean, look at the nepotism there. Of course, you're going to see her album everywhere because of Ozzy mm-hmm. Osbourne. You know, mm-hmm. oh, if it wasn't for Ozzy Osbourne, Kelly wouldn't have a record and she wouldn't even be alive. So it's like, mm-hmm. you know, it's kind of like, so we were, I think, a good, different, unique band that didn't intentionally ride the coattails of that. We mm-hmm. were already a part of it. We were already doing it. Mm-hmm. So when we became the Jackass band, it was fine because it didn't matter, because the music was more important. If we had been a bad band and mm-hmm. we were with Jackass, we wouldn't have gotten anywhere, I don't think, because there were a lot of other Jackass bands that people don't remember. We weren't the only one. We were by far the only Jackass band. Mm-hmm. There were other bands, but they just usually were just somebody's favorite band because, for whatever reason, but because of our music and the way we sounded and how unique we were is the reason why we didn't die off with that show. But it did get to the point where it started to feel like a lot of people were not even interested in music, and they were going to the shows for that mm-hmm. reason.
For that reason,
hoping to see Bam or Rake or Brandon or anybody like that. And that got frustrating because you go out and talk to the crowd, and they're like, "Oh, is Brandon here or is Bam here?" And it's like, "No, that's not what this is." And because of how unique that situation was, being friends with all those guys and having different jobs and different things going on. It, of course, you're going to expect to see Brandon or Bam or Chris mm-hmm. Rabb or Ray show up on stage, you know, because we're all friends mm-hmm. and we sold it like that. True. So, yeah, mm-hmm. but I mean, and just, you know, that had run its course. We had a good run, you know, nobody's really doing, you know, that stuff anymore. I mm-hmm. think a Jackass came out recently.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, this year. It's
all new people. I don't know. It was a gift, you know, it worked. But mm-hmm. it ran its course. and it, you know, it was a good run there. It worked perfectly for everybody. Everybody benefited from it, but I'm happy to be in a situation where, you know, I don't have to worry about.
Yeah. You know, I was going to say, yeah. I mean, do you now look at it as like, okay, now I don't even have to worry about that anymore. I could just let the music do the talking. I have to worry about the whole name and, you know, connection and all that stuff. Right.
I shouldn't say worry about it. I never really worried about it. I just always knew that the music, if it was good, people were going to say, oh, this isn't just some band on a TV show, which, you know, a lot of bands on TV shows, like I said, aren't that good. Mm-hmm. But I didn't say, it's not like I started a band and said, finally, you know, I'm out of the Jackass world. It's not like at all. It just happened to be something that worked out, and it was very legitimate. It had street cred before it got commercial, and it just ran its course. Nobody said, I can't take Jackass shit anymore, and it wasn't like that. I just needed to start another band. Once the other band ran its course, I had to start a new band. So I started this band, and I continued to do what I was doing. Mm-hmm. And if Jackass wanted to put a song on a show, I'd say sure, because the music is what it's all about. But, you know, I just have too much passion for music that if I couldn't get it out there, I'd do it by myself here in this room. You know, it doesn't have anything to do with it. It's something I have to do. It's the only thing I know how to do pretty much very, very, very well. Been doing this for 35, 40 years making music. So it's my calling card. It's what I am. So like to act too, but I'm not as good at that yet as I want to be.
Yeah. A lot of competition in music too, but acting is probably even tougher to break into, you know? Yeah, no doubt. Well, you know, when I first noticed a band, when you guys were signed to Nuclear Blast, you know, I got to say, I was a bit surprised because, I mean, traditionally, I know Nuclear Blast is primarily extreme, you know, metal label. And I know that obviously, you know, you come from a death metal background. You've obviously have a lot of influences. Obviously, also, you've got your other projects, Foreign Objects and World Under Blood, I know was on Nuclear Blast. So obviously, you already had a relationship there, but I was just, you know, curious, I guess, with your relationship with them and the fact that they really decided to invest in a more of a traditional heavy rock band like 96 Bitter Beans, considering it is a bit of a departure from usually the type of music they put out.
Well, they are pretty much barely known for extreme metal and thrash, but they also work with a lot of rock bands that, like Graveyard, got signed to Nuclear when they were opening for us back in the day. Sure. They're a rock band. There's been a lot of rock bands on Nuclear Blast. I can't really think of how many. Yeah, they are primarily known, especially now they're signing legendary metal bands, not so much as extreme as before, but they're, you know, they had Slayer and Testament and Exodus, and they also had an all rock band a couple years ago. I mean, they're open to sign anything rock and metal. But, you know, it's right now finding any band to sign is proving to be difficult. They talk about it all the time. Record companies talk about how there's not that much up and coming good talent.
Yeah.
And even the people that are up and coming and are talented don't know like that they're what record label is, or no, they find their own ways to release their music. And that's cool too. True. But, you know, I'm just, like I said, with being able to go to a record store, I also need and enjoy and want the help from a record company.
Mm-hmm.
So it's a partnership to get music out there, and it's working. It works. You know, if the band tries to tackle everything, we're going to spread ourselves too thin. And that's what we did for the first album, is just did it all by ourselves. And how bands do it now is just totally online and printing up our own stuff, but it got to be too much. So this is where we went. And I love everybody at Nuclear Blast. I know almost everybody there, and we've been friends and business partners for decades.
Yeah, and it's pretty arguably the biggest, you know, rock and metal label on the planet. So, yeah, you know, you can't get really much bigger than that. So, yeah, absolutely.
I would never be able to sign with somebody that I didn't know anybody there. That would be really fucking scary for me to walk into, you know, some record company where I don't know a single person. and I have to talk to these people that I don't know, it's very difficult. It would be very difficult for me. So I'm 25 minutes from the office, you know, it's just much easier. And like I said, everybody I know that is there that I know, I love them.
Sure. No, absolutely. Now, in terms of touring, you know, I know you just past summer, you guys toured with a great band, Howling Giant, who are, you know, they're more of a stoner rock band. Sorry?
That was in 2020. Oh, no. Howling Giant. Okay. Yeah. Howl was 2020.
Okay. Really another Howl. Too. Okay. Yeah.
Howl, another Howling band. Right.
Another Howl.
Yeah. Okay. Howling Giant. They're amazing. They're an amazing three-piece band.
Yeah, what I was going to say, though, you know, because, I mean, you've got, you know, obviously a few songs that are in that, maybe, you know, they're, you know, I guess more of a stoner rock band. You've got some songs that are sort of obviously in that arena, but you're not even close to being a stoner rock band, per se.
We and were like labeled you were saying, that a lot.
Really? Well, I know, yeah, early days, right? You guys were, yeah.
New stoner rock, skater punk, new metal, all that stuff.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, I was going to say, I mean, how difficult is it or easy it really for you guys, because you're so unique, to sort of find maybe the right band or bands to kind of go out and hit the road with, so that, you know, you're hitting the right fan base and those fans will obviously understand and embrace your music when you are touring, since you have such a unique sound? Is that been difficult so far, have you found, or has everything been pretty smooth in terms of that?
Well, it's been smooth. I take out anybody as long as they're not assholes. I would want to be taken out by any band as long as they don't see me as an asshole. As far as the music, I could play with anybody. You know, I can have anybody open for the band, or I could open for anybody. It doesn't really, I mean, of course there's a limit, you know, Barbara Streisand and 96 Bitter Beings wouldn't work, but I mean, if it's rock or metal, you know, I mean, playing in front of the Guns N' Roses audience, I don't think you could get more, it could get more scary than that. You know, nobody wants to hear, you know, an opening band if they want to see Axl Rose. Same with Metallica. True. And we did both. So I'm not really, you know, I would go out with anybody, and I would allow anybody to open for us as long as they were easy to get along with. And the booking agents know that. The booking agents know if the bands are easy to get along with or not. So that's pretty much the only rule. Don't send us out with assholes.
Well, you know, my last question for you, Deron, I mean, you know, now in terms of what, you know, in terms of what you want to accomplish at this point in your career with the band, I mean, you know, with CKY, you've done and have experienced some great things over the years. You've been on major labels, major independent labels. You played on the Warped Tour, as you was just talking about. You've opened for Guns N' Roses, played with Metallica. Tour with Clutch. Avenged Sevenfold. Clutch, all these great bands.
It's funny because Clutch opened for us in Europe.
Oh, really?
And wow, I don't think anybody would believe that. But yeah, we went to Europe with them, and it was a really good time, and they were opening for us. And I didn't even believe it back then, because we definitely opened for them a lot in the States, I think. But when we were going to Europe, they opened for us, and it was really interesting because I didn't get it. I thought they were way, way bigger. But yeah, I mean, I'm up for whatever. I'm sorry I interrupted you.
No, it's all good. No, I was just going to say, I mean, what are you hoping to accomplish really now, considering, for one, too, that the business really as a whole, you know, I mean, obviously you're in a good situation, obviously, with your label, with Nuclear Blast, but the business as a whole, obviously, it's probably in the worst shape it's ever been, in my opinion. I mean,
oh, absolutely. Is
this, yeah. So are you simply really just doing this more out of pure passion, like you saying you have to do it kind of thing? Or is there any other kind of maybe goals or aspirations you have right now as a musician?
A little bit of both. I'm just going to go with the flow. I think that the best power or the best push that music can get is word of mouth.
Mm-hmm. And I agree. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I have goals for the future and where I want to be. But as far as, you know, like you said, whether what I want to happen is going to happen or not, or part of it's going to happen, I'm just going with the flow. And I don't want to make all of these, you know, mental things in my head where, oh, I have to be here by here and I have to be at this place by this place. Mm-hmm. That used to drive me nuts. Mm-hmm. Because that consumed me and it made me not, you know, pay attention to what was the most important thing. Mm-hmm. So now I enjoy how the business is right now. I think it's interesting. I think that a lot of the old ideas that weren't around 10 or 15 years ago are coming back, such as the physical formats and the vinyl and all that stuff. Mm-hmm. And that's what I primarily enjoy about it. I want to help wake people up to rock and metal being a mainstream thing as it used to be and as it should be. Like somebody just made reference to the fact that they won't, the Super Bowl won't let Metallica play or something, or
yeah,
metal. Mm-hmm. They don't allow metal bands on the Grammys or, you know, they don't do that, and that's fine. But I think that eventually it's going to swing back around where I think that there's a lot of kids that have all this pent up anxiety and testosterone or whatever, and they have nowhere to release that anxiety, and they're going out and they're releasing it in much more dangerous ways. Mm-hmm. You know, where a mosh pit or stage diving or banging your head used to be what got all that pent up anger out.
Absolutely. And now
you can't get that from trying to listen to Beyonce or
yeah.
You know, Laz, whatever the fuck, The Weeknd or something like
yeah.
that. Like,
mm-hmm.
You can't listen to that. And that's what kids think right now is music. And when yes. I'm driving my kids to school, I do see some metalheads, you know. There are some kids that know about it. And that's how it started. It was one or two, three, maybe five kids in school were wearing that stuff. And then it mm-hmm. just caught on. And I think that that's exactly what it's going to do again, because history repeats. It's been 20 years since rock and metal were the biggest type of music, just like mm-hmm. horror comes and goes.
Mm-hmm.
Horror slasher films, zombie films, all that stuff is hot one minute and then it goes underground and then it just comes swings right back up again, and it happens like every 15 to 20 years.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm just here, you know, mostly for fun and for the passion of it. I just want to see where this goes. I'm open-minded mm-hmm. to where this all ends up, and that's mm-hmm. that makes it exciting for me, is just to see where this all ends up.
Sure. Yeah. Well, the one thing that kind of worries me about, you know, future rock and metal is, you know, I agree. I think it's going to come back, and it kind of already is a little bit. But
mm-hmm.
what's happened is there's been sort of this dissolution of the band. You know, everything is individual and solo now. You don't see
yeah.
bands. Even people, I mean, even these great, you know, musicians you see on YouTube, I mean, they're virtuosos, yet they couldn't play with anybody in the same room. They'd have no idea how to even do it. You know, that's the only thing that worries me about the future is, you know, I mean, you can't have just one person be a solo artist and be this great big, you know, metal or rock music, you know, band and musician. I mean, it's just everything's so individual now, and people just don't know how to play music together. You know,
nope, you're right. It's because of the I think it's my age group's lack of good parenting.
I agree. Yep. Mm-hmm.
And keeping, you know, kids yeah. these days professional and hungry for stuff and not just getting things that they ask for immediately, which mm-hmm. on the computer is just one click away. Mm-hmm. And a lot of them don't know that you have to work and develop talent and stay professional and stay strong about it. No matter how difficult it gets, you have to stick with it.
Mm-hmm.
And there isn't a lot, a very small percentage of young kids that are interested in things give up really easily, but sure. it's refreshing when you do find a young band that mm-hmm. is working together, is trying to make it work. They just might not have, you know, the talent, but eventually, you know, it just catches on. And I think this whole attitude where our kids are at right now of getting everything they want is going to get old, and people are going to start to realize that it's more fun to start working for what you want, mm-hmm. because eventually they're going to have to work at some point anyway. So, mm-hmm. you know, it's just, you're right. It is a lot of solo artists, and I guess people are just, they don't have the life experiences to be able to put up with other people being in their area.
Mm-hmm. You know, yeah,
exactly. Bands are like three-way marriages, four-way marriages, and people give up really quickly and drop their friends really easily.
Mm-hmm.
And that's just the way it is right now. But I think that's going to change because it can't get any worse.
Well, that's a good point. Yeah, that is true. You can't get worse. It's pretty much rock bottom right now. So,
yeah.
Well, I hope you're right, man, obviously. So, yeah, I mean, let's keep our fingers crossed. But anyway, all right, man. Well, the band is 96 Bitter Beings. They got a brand new album coming out titled Synergy Restore. It's out November 4th on Nuclear Blast. And, Deron, what should we send the viewers to keep up with the band and purchase the new record in November and everything?
Typical socials, you know, 96 Bitter Beings official on Instagram. God, I'm put on the spot. Just they're obvious. You know, we have the Facebook and the Instagram mm-hmm. and the probably Twitter, TikTok. I'm not much of a you know, social media person. Mm-hmm. I stopped paying attention to all that stuff because I got way too involved in a negative aspect. So I don't do mm-hmm. that anymore. But we have our website, 96bitterbeings.com. I mean, you just Google us, you know.
Okay.
We have a single Fire Skyline coming out tomorrow. The album you can get, I have a Big Cartel store. I think it's ckyrockandmetal.bigcartel.com. I sell a lot of stuff on there. You can get the album through that store. You can get it on Amazon. It's available for pre-order everywhere. There's four different variants of vinyl, which I'm really psyched about.
Oh, nice. Very cool.
So yeah,
different, I mean, different colored vinyl. Is it like different?
Well, yeah, we have two different splatter versions. We have a picture disc and regular black, and the regular black and the picture discs are sold through our store, specifically, exclusively. It was really cool that they printed up a couple hundred just through the store through the band.
Oh, very cool. Nice. Yeah. Awesome, man. Well, and any, just quickly, any plans for any more shows or touring coming up soon? Or
we're working on a European tour, and we're working on for early 2023 being trying to get an opening act tour, because I haven't opened for anybody in 25-30 years. Wow. And mm-hmm. 95% headliners, and you know, I'd like to, you know, have that 30 minutes to just woo the other audience and bring them over to our side. So
sure.
I haven't been able to do that in so long because we were always headlining.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, it's gotta be kind of different than obviously. And well, I guess strange when you first do it, when you get out there and do that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But I enjoy it. You know, it's a challenge, and I enjoy going up against Axl Rose's fans. And you know, if they want to have a problem, you know, it's fine because that's just the way it works. It's just part of it. And a lot of people, mm-hmm. would probably throw their guitar down and cry these days. And that's probably why we don't have a lot of bands right now, but it's just part of it. You just have to stick to it no matter what happens, you know, no matter anything that can happen to you, no matter what anybody says, no matter what anybody thinks, you just stick to what you love to do and don't listen to anybody tell you, you know, anything. You know, I've said a lot of bands are horrible and never going to make it, and they end up making it and becoming huge. So it doesn't matter what anybody thinks. You just stick with it and you go.
Yeah. No, absolutely. Absolutely. Totally agree. Well, once again, 96 Bitter Bee and Synergy Restored on Nuclear Blast out November 4th. And Deron, once again, man, appreciate you coming on to talk to us, man. We'll see you on the road soon.
All right. Thanks, man. I appreciate it.